So today in the morning session, which may be a little bit long, so I do beg your patience, we're going to go over chapters 3 and chapters 4 of the book. And basically, they are looking at or reviewing the different methodologies that many authors have come up with since at least the 1970s, if not earlier, for measuring multidimensional poverty. Why should you listen to this session? Why should you pay attention? One is that you may be from a different tradition. In introductions, people mentioned that they had used principal component analysis for constructing measures previously, or that they had used fuzzy set analysis. And so it might be quite interesting for you to think over the techniques you have already used and compare them with the techniques we'll be using and teaching in the next week and a half. Another reason to listen is that if you are proposing a measure, if you're a student, if you're writing your literature review and trying to justify the measure that you use, you might want to review other methodologies that either have been used with that data set or in that country, or that might qualify to do the job, and then say why the measure or methodology that you are using is correct. If you are in policy, there may be somebody who asks you a question when you're in front of 200, 300 people and say, why didn't you use X? Why didn't you use a composite index like the Human Poverty Index? Or why didn't you use a different axiomatic index like the Bergignon Chakravarti 2003? You'll be put on the spot and you'll have to answer. So hopefully this morning will help you. In the chapters themselves, there are a lot more references to reading materials, to papers, and a lot of the techniques and applications are discussed in a lot more detail than I'll do this morning. But that's the motivation. And the other motivation is that you may, at the end of this, decide to go in a different direction, decide that your interest is in developing a different set of techniques. And maybe this will give you a map of what those might be. And also, it's just simply important to validate the work that has gone before. If you come from Latin America or from the Middle East or the Arab states, there's been a lot of work on unmet basic needs. Understanding it, validating it, being able to articulate how your work stands on the shoulders of those who have gone before and how you go beyond what they could do, that can be quite useful. So that's, in a sense, why we take this session to look and do a very, very quick review of many methodologies. Now, when we are reviewing methodologies, each one of these has many different applications, many different adjustments that can be made. And it is impossible for me to share all of them with you. And it is impossible also for our book chapters to do justice to the richness of the literature. But what we've tried to do is the following. First of all, to come up with a consistent notation so that a Z always, or a Z, depending where you are from, always means a deprivation cutoff. D always means the number of dimensions considered, the columns in the matrix. N always means the number of people. And so we're reframing these different methodologies in a common notation. And then we're trying to synthesize what we understand to be the most relevant aspects of those methodologies for poverty measurement, because many of them are used for other things as well. Of course, you may know things we don't, so please come and tell us after class if there are things we've left out or if you think we've gotten something wrong, because we'd be very interested in your inputs. And the remaining methodologies do reflect the joint distribution of deprivations. They're a row first order of aggregation method, and they therefore are quite interesting, because one of the emphases of this entire course is how do we look at the clustering of deprivations that batter poor people together. So we'll start with a dashboard approach. It's probably the most familiar. We're going to make it sound very complicated, so it sounds very serious. You know what it is. It's simply a set of indicators like the percentage of children who are not attending school, the ratio of girls and boys attending primary school, the maternal mortality rates, the deaths of women per 100,000 women, or the child mortality rates the deaths of children per 1,000 children. And so what a dashboard does is it, in a sense, takes a set of unidimensional indicators for dimensions and applies them. And this was justified many different ways. The Hicks and Streeton book on basic needs in 1979, First Things First, argued that as a first step, it might be useful to find the best indicator for each basic need, one entry on your dashboard. The Millennium Development Goals agreed in the year 2000, initially used 49 indicators. That was later extended in successive rounds of the Interagency Expert Working Group to include additional indicators. So very simply, if there is a population which is covered by dimension J, and as I'll mention, the base populations or the NJs are not the same for each of the entries in the dashboard necessarily, then there might be a vector summarizing the achievements of all people. And usually a dashboard may include or it may not include a deprivation cutoff. For example, the percentage of children who are malnourished implicitly includes a cutoff of malnutrition. And so that's one way of doing a deprivation index for a dimension. But of course, a gender parity ratio is a different kind of an index. And a dashboard of indicators is simply a vector, a set of indicators for different deprivations. So what are some examples? I've mentioned some of them. The percentage of people, the headcount ratio of people who are below a dollar a day, the share of women in wage employment, net enrollment ratio in primary education, proportion of tuberculosis cases detected and cured under DOTS, the proportion of seats held by women in parliament, and so on. So this is very simple. It's very appealing because it enriches the information that we look at. An interesting thing to note about dashboards is that often what we call the base population or the reference population, which may be the denominator, or it may be the population for which that particular data are collected, differs for different indicators. It's not necessarily the same. So they may be disjoint sets of people. And in that case, there may not be overlapping groups, and it may be impossible to look at the joint distribution. I'll unpack that. That's a dashboard. But what's the base population of people who are living under a dollar a day? It's everybody in the population, right? What's the base population for, the share of women in wage employment in the non-agricultural sector? It's the total number of people who are employed in the non-agricultural sector. What's the base population for the net enrollment ratio in primary education? It's the number of kids, children of official school age, for primary school, and so on. So the base populations may vary across these different MDGs. And it's important, as we start to focus and understand joint deprivations, to always start to think about what's the denominator, from whom in the household is this information collected, or from whom in the society does this, to whom in the society does this information refer? That's a basic point, but are you with me? Yeah. We're getting up some terminology up and running. So what are the advantages of the dashboard approach? Basically, as an approach to looking at multidimensional poverty. For example, Martin Ravalian, in a 2011 article, argued that anything that could be put into a unidimensional measure should, and that other things should be presented as elements of a dashboard. So a dashboard basically can share information on other dimensions of poverty. So it does reflect the many dimensions of poverty. It can use cardinal data, like income, using a gap or square gap to poverty measure, for example, or ordinal data, like homicide rates. It can draw on different data sources. So if you think of that wheel of different illustrative MDGs, they used labor force surveys, they used special health surveys, they used consumption and expenditure surveys, DHS surveys, administrative data. They can also show information on these disjoint populations. They can portray indicators with different base or reference populations, like the proportion of seats held by women in parliament. It is difficult and needs translation to look at the joint distribution of deprivations for disjoint populations, because you have to translate them into a common unit of analysis or unit of identification. And again, we'll go into this again, and you'll see this with many examples, but it's important to note right now. And also, a dashboard can show indicators which would have very different magnitudes if they were measured with respect to the same unit of identification. For example, consider maternal mortality. Maternal mortality is a grievous deprivation. It's a disadvantage we should fight and confront. And yet we measure it by the number of deaths per 100,000 women. It's a relatively rare event. Also, the data that we use to measure it are quite weak. But if we put together maternal mortality measured in terms of 100,000 women with child school attendance measured as a percentage, then the incidence of maternal mortality would be very, very low. And it might almost disappear in a measure, or you would have to put such a high weight on it to make it visible that it would distort the measure. And so for these reasons, in a sense, no matter what we do with multidimensional poverty measurement, as we will construct it in a single methodology, there will be some indicators that don't fit. They come from different surveys, they're very rare events, they pertain to special populations. So we will always need a dashboard. But the question is, what can and should perhaps go into a dashboard, and what can and should perhaps go into a measure that reflects the overlapping deprivations? Are you with me? Yeah? There are some disadvantages with dashboards, because if we know we will need them, then why put things together? Why not just stay with a dashboard? It's very simple, right? Everyone can understand it. One which the Stiglitz-Sanfilippo Commission observed was that dashboards can be quite heterogeneous and they can be quite large. For example, the MDG dashboard initially had 49 indicators and then it went up to over 60. Now, if you had 60 indicators on your car, you would crash. And which one is most important? Is it how fast you're going? Is it the petrol you're running out of? Is it the number of revs? Is it the temperature in the car? Is it the noise of other people in the car? So there's no hierarchy in a dashboard necessarily. There's no weighting. There's no sense of which indicator is the most important. And so that is perhaps a drawback, that everything is, in a sense, one indicator, one vote. And it simply does not specify any priorities. And again, deep across indicators, and yet when you are allocating your budget, you are weighting different deprivations or different priorities against each other. A budget allocation must, in a sense, ex post be understood as weights, as Kaushik Basu's DPhil thesis, PhD thesis, clarified. And dashboards doesn't apply any weights. And in not applying weights, it doesn't necessarily catalyze discussion, disagreement, analysis of what the weights or the trade-offs should be, whether this is by civil society or whether it's by others. A second kind of disadvantage is that there is no summary measure. So there's 60 indicators. And there were 60 indicators last year, and you're updating the global monitoring report for the MDGs for your country, and there's 60 indicators this year. And some have gone down, and some have gone up, and some have stayed the same. And then your head of state comes to you and says, okay, what happened to the MDGs? I want a headline. And there, you know all of the detail. You know all of the individual trends. But how do you summarize in a way that a very busy, very... perhaps a person that's not interested in hearing your two-hour lecture on each of the indicators how they would really be able to take it in. So again, the Stiglitz-Sanfitucci Commission observed that what had made GDP a success, and in a sense what made HDI a success in its day, was that there was a single headline figure, and it allowed simple comparisons across countries for international measures or across regions for national measures, and over time. We were a bit cheeky, but in a paper with James Foster and, Santos, Mariama Santos, we observed that the prospect of headlines like government says poverty is higher, lower, and unchanged hardly inspires confidence. So your journalist comes up to you with your 60 indicator, says, what's your headline? And you say poverty is higher, lower, and unchanged. And the journalist walks away. So having a single measure like a dollar a day poverty has gone down, national poverty has gone down, it's gone up in this region, that in a sense has a communication power for civil society and for policy, which a large dashboard doesn't have. And I should say that until I began working on this, I was very much a person that favored dashboards. And so I certainly had a change of thought myself. Then the third kind of disadvantage of dashboards is that they overlook the joint distribution of deprivations. Shimon touched on that yesterday. I mentioned it yesterday. Let's just spend a minute making sure that everybody is very clear on what we mean. So we have four people, Peter, Anna, John, and Paula. And we don't have a pointer. There are two societies or two periods or whatever. In the first, Peter is nourished but has no other deprivation. Anna is uneducated but has no other deprivation. John has no safe water. And Paula has no electricity. So that's society in society A, society in time period A. In society in time period B, Peter experiences all four deprivations. And Anna, John, and Paula do not experience any. Okay? If you were to make a dashboard showing the percentage of people who are undernourished, the percentage of people who are uneducated, the percentage of people who have no safe water, and the percentage of people who have no electricity in those two societies, which society is worse? Hello? Same. Right. So why are they the same? It's because we are adding vertically. So the headcount ratio is simply vertical. So it's one in each of these columns, the column first aggregation order, right? And the total, one out of four for each of these, we're going to call a marginal measure. And we're going to call a marginal measure because it is only looking at this column and it is ignoring all the other columns. So that's terminology. A marginal measure will be the sum or the headcount ratio of each of these columns individually. And a joint measure, a measure that looks at joint distribution, will first go this way. So if we look at a measure which reflects the joint distribution of deprivation, do we see something different?
Yes.
Okay? Peter is well off or poor off, deprived if we have one as being a deprivation. Yeah. So that is the disadvantage of dashboards. Dashboards take these numbers. So according to a dashboard, these two societies are the same. And what we're trying to do is go beyond them now to look across the different deprivations for the same person. Because if you have 30% of children malnourished and 30% of children who are out of school, you don't know if the same 30% of children experience both, if 30% of children who are malnourished are all going to school, or what percentage of children experience both. And that is the kind of information now that we are trying to introduce into poverty measurement. Is that clear? I know it's simple, but don't worry, it'll get more interesting. So in summary, the dashboard doesn't give a hierarchy across the indicators. It doesn't give a single headline figure. It doesn't address issues of trade-offs. It also doesn't identify who is multidimensionally poor across these different indicators. and it ignores the joint distribution. So that's very briefly an overview of dashboards. Now, the most common way of going beyond a dashboard is to build what we will call a composite index. And this is a composite index. A composite index, as we are defining it, takes the marginal measures, right? Takes the elements of the dashboard and aggregates them. So the deprivation indices we defined earlier are the entries in the dashboard, and you are somehow going to put them together in an index. And there are many examples of these. So the PQLI by Morris in 78 is an example. The Human Development Index, it's not a poverty measure, but it is an example of a composite index, as is the Inequality Adjusted HDI, the Gender Indices, the Doing Business Index, the Mo Ibrahim Index of Governance, the Global Peace Index, Commitment to Development, Social Progress, Prosperity, or the Transparency International. So all of these have a similar construction. They use marginal measures or dashboard entries, and they aggregate across them. We got into this yesterday when we talked about how the HDI summarizes life expectancy, income per capita, and average years of schooling and school life expectancy. Just to give you an example, in 1997, Sudhir Anand and Amartya Sen constructed the Human Poverty Index. In 1997, as you'll remember from the data discussion we had yesterday, there was not enough microdata available to construct an internationally comparable Human Poverty Index that used microdata from the same survey. So they had to, in the 1990s, use marginal measures. And it is a general mean of order three, of three dimensions and four indicators. The probability of not surviving to the age of 40, adult illiteracy, the population without access to improved water, and the percent of children who are underweight for age. You cube each index and then take the average of it and the cube root. So that's an example, but that uses these marginal measures, so it does not reflect the joint distribution. So are you all clear on composite indices? I think they're widely used. If you would like a reference on it, there's a very good handbook on composite indices done by the Joint Research Center in Italy, Andrea Saltelli and co-authors. So what are the advantages of the composite measures? As Stiglitz and Fitoussi acknowledged, they do provide a summary indicator. So HPI was used to rank countries. Famously, the HDI is used, and it gets press attention every year for its rank of countries, as does Transparency International or the Mo Ibrahim Index of Governance. You can also use cardinal or ordinal data because it is summarized into a single index. You can combine different data sources because you're not looking at the joint distribution. And so therefore, you can combine information on disjoint populations that we defined earlier. And you may also want to normalize your indices, which will enable you to include relatively rare events in your index. And a composite indicator does have a hierarchy and does make trade-offs explicit. We will talk when we speak of the normative judgments tomorrow a little bit about how demanding those trade-offs are. And in this, I would certainly agree that the marginal rates of substitution are not incidental in constructing some of these measures. But these are some of the advantages because the trade-offs can be seen and debated. What are the disadvantages? In the Human Poverty Index, you could not say how many percent of the people were multidimensionally poor. You could rank countries with a cardinally meaningful number, but you couldn't identify who was poor. And this is for several reasons. If you are combining, as the HPI did, indicators that refer to different populations, a society-wide probability of an adult illiteracy, a society-wide access to water, and a children-specific weight for age variable, then how do you put them together? Because you've not identified a particular unit of identification. If you are combining people, all of them are population-wide indices, for example, implicitly you are using a union approach in that any deprivation matters. But because you have used the marginal measures, you still do not know how many people are poor. And if you're interested, I can show you how you can actually make an M0 measure using union from marginal measures, but you can never pull out of it the headcount ratio, the percentage of people who are poor. And yet that's what policymakers understand. It also doesn't, therefore, show intensity, as we saw the joint distribution or the number of deprivations that people experience. Also, composite measures have different ways of aggregating across the indicators, and each of those aggregation methodologies fulfill or violate a set of properties, which will be specific to the aggregation form. And similarly, its ease of understanding, for example, will depend on the normalization and on the complexity of its construction. I think we already went over this, so I'm sorry this slide is out of order, but in terms of joint distribution, if you prefer to see it in the matrix, then the joint distribution only aggregates vertically across all people in society for a given dimension. So those two approaches, dashboards and composite indices, do not reflect the joint distribution of deprivations, but are very widely used and certainly serve some purpose. And will continue to be used because we cannot pack everything into a household survey. We do need topical surveys. So we will continue to use these different methodologies. Now I would like to focus on five methods that do use microdata and reflect the joint distribution of deprivations. We start with Venn diagrams. Venn diagrams are basically the circles that you all know, chapati diagrams, pie diagrams, different ways of expressing them, but they're a set of closed figures that show all possible logical relations between a finite number of dimensions with binary options. You are in the set or out of the set. And the population is all entirely categorized, exhaustively categorized as being in or out of each set of dimensions. And these were introduced formally by John Venn, after whom they're named, but he even mentioned that they were used earlier, and they were called Eulerian circles previously, and they were even used before Euler. So there's a long history to these. When there are only two dimensions, just to begin in the most simple case, the Venn diagram is basically depicting a 2x2 contingency table or crosstab. So you have two dimensions, dimension one on the vertical, dimension two on the horizontal, and then you exhaustively partition the population into four groups, those who are not deprived in either, N00, those who are deprived in both, N11, and those who are deprived in one deprivation, but not the other, 10, or deprivation two and not one, dimension two, not one. And these four numbers, 00, 01, 10, and 11, are simply depicted here. So it hopefully very intuitive. These people are deprived in both, and in one, and in none. And they add up to 100% of the population. So every person is mapped on a Venn diagram in the reference population. And we saw this yesterday with three dimensions in the EU 2020 measure. Where we looked at income, poverty, material deprivation, and joblessness. And it's clearly easier to read than a 3x3 contingency table. And you can put this in the newspaper, and people can understand it. So there's a good value to Venn diagrams. But it's harder to read when you go to four or five dimensions. And then you begin to lose your audience. So what are the advantages? It's a visual tool. It's a visual tool which is, you know, in a paper by Chico Ferreira at the World Bank with Mariana Lugo, You know, they would like a comeback of Venn diagrams. So it's also a current visual tool. That their paper is 2013. And it basically maps the overlapping and non-overlapping binary deprivations in a way that's accessible. It can use cardinal or ordinal data. It does show very accurately the joint distribution, and it's intuitive and easy to understand, at least for a few dimensions. And you can also see visually the population that are deprived in at least one of the deprivations. So the area of the two circles together shows people who are deprived in at least one of the dimensions, whichever they be. And that is what, of course, is used in the EU 2020 measure. The disadvantage is that they may not identify who is multidimensionally poor. So in this diagram, is it people who are deprived in at least one, at least two, at least three? You would need somebody to basically highlight the people who are poor and define them. And Venn diagrams themselves don't do that. It relies on the analysts whether or not they go that extra step. Sorry. They also don't necessarily create a summary measure, a single overlap headline figure. And so they cannot construct a complete ordering or a ranking, whether it's of states of your country or of countries or of population groups or ethnic or age groups. They require binary data. You are in the set or out of it. And so they lose any information that might be present in cardinal data, like years of schooling or income. It's any information on the depth of deprivations, for example. And because there is no numerical value, you cannot make a table for people to download in Excel. You know, how do you depict it? Simply, you have to make a lot of maps for the different states, which is fine if your country has five, and not if it has 39. So there are some, in a sense, constraints to using it as an overall measure. Any questions before I move on to dominance? Because we've covered what I believe is very, very widely known and familiar to most of everyone here. And then we'll go on to some other approaches. There is a coffee machine upstairs, if you feel the need. Okay, now we'll move on to stochastic dominance and the dominance approaches. And Schumann already touched on those yesterday in his presentation of unidimensional poverty measures or methods. And these are very important in multidimensional spaces as well as unidimensional spaces. And Duclos, Son, and Younger's work, published initially in 2006, has really been a leading voice on these methods. And the question that they pose is, if we have the underlying data set, can we, simply looking at that data of achievements, ascertain whether poverty is unambiguously lower in society A than B, whatever cutoffs, weights, and poverty line is chosen? So regardless of the parameters that we fix, and regardless of the functional form of the poverty measure, we can see from looking at the data that poverty would always be lower in one society than another. So that's what he explained in unidimensional terms, because when you can see that, you have a very, very, very strong result, first order stochastic dominance. And it also has very strong political power because, again, regardless of it cannot be criticized, the finding. And you certainly want to avoid a situation in which one group creates one poverty measure with one ranking and another group creates another poverty measure with the reverse ranking. So contradictory rankings are confusing for the public, and they lead to a lack of confidence in national statistics. And you may know that one of the motivations for the Stiglitz-Sanfantucci Commission was this widespread current lack of confidence in government statistics. Because they don't seem to be accurate and they don't seem to reflect people's experience. Very good. So the earliest extension of dominance approaches to the multidimensional space was the Atkinson and Bourguignon well-known paper in 1982. And it's also been treated in these other citations. And the key tool in that we already saw yesterday is the CDF, or cumulative distribution function. And we already went over yesterday how the CDFs relate to each other, whether or not they cross, is key to understanding the dominance relationship, and also how to read the CDF. The proportion of people is given by fx of b. So this maps to here. So Duclos, San, and Younger in 2006 simply take that to more dimensions. And two dimensions is the very easiest to see. So you have two CDFs that are mapped in three-dimensional space there. It's the height for age z-score on this axis, and the log of per capita household expenditure on this axis. And you have the dominant surface for Ghanaian children in 1989 in this picture. And then you look at the difference between two two-dimensional CDFs. And so this maps the difference, the urban minus the rural dominant surfaces in the case of Vietnam. So are you with me? Before we were looking at the two CDFs, and now we're looking at the difference. But now we've moved to three-dimensional space. So this is the difference. And there's a negative difference for all points of the two surfaces between urban and rural areas of Vietnam. So we do have a dominance result. Zero is here. And you see that everything is below zero. Everything is negative. So for this two-dimensional case, we do have a dominance result. And there are many other applied work, and you can talk with Buba, wherever Buba is. Buba knows this literature very well and has worked in it himself. But for example, they looked at stunting and child survival probability in Cameroon and Madagascar, and found that by univariate dominance, Madagascar is poorer than Cameroon by either of those two indicators. But when they put those two indicators together and look at the joint distribution, they don't find a dominance result. So that's the importance of not simply sticking with two unidimensional comparisons, but now moving to multidimensional dominance. There is a lot that can be done. And if you are interested, I do suggest going further. We're not going to go further into this literature. But the key strength of dominance approaches is that when you find a result, it's a very, very strong empirical assertion about poverty comparisons, because it's complete. Dominance also, as we saw, can consider multiple dimensions. And it can use discrete or continuous data. So initially, the findings used continuous data, and later were extended for discrete. And it then, because it holds no matter what poverty measure is applied, you don't have to make any decisions on the parameter values. Although, of course, it doesn't promote discussion or thought about them. But what are the disadvantages? One is you can rank two countries, but there is no summary measure. So it doesn't show the cardinally meaningful differences. So you can say that Madagascar is more or less poor than Somalia, and compare that with Malaysia, and compare that with Mexico, and compare that with some other period. But you can't say how much poorer. You can just do pairwise ranking. So there's no cardinally meaningful distance between the results. They also depend on the relationship between dimensions, and they usually assume substitutability. There are also, I don't know if I slide on this. There's some more. But there are some very real practical difficulties that those of you who are interested in empirical work will quickly run into, which is the sample size issue. When you have more than two dimensions, and particularly more than three, the data sets have to be very, very large to apply dominance techniques. So Duclos, Sun, and Younger said, in theory, extending our result to more than two dimensions is straightforward. But in practice, most existing data sets in developing countries are probably not large enough to support tests on more than a few dimensions of well-being, which is usually two or three, and they have certainly done three. And then we've just been talking about first order dominance, but dominance beyond first order, second or third order, also has more stringent conditions on individual level poverty functions, right? So for each person that you're comparing the multiple deprivations for. Okay, so that's dominance. Are there any immediate concerns there? It's just giving a bit of a review, and I really do rely on you to go deeper where you need to. So we'll turn now to statistical approaches, and I, again, will only present a subset of these for lack of time. So statistical approaches are principal component analysis, factor analysis, multiple correspondence analysis, other latent variable techniques, structural equation modeling. And they all, in a sense, have a primary aim, which is to reduce dimensionality by reflecting on some aspect of the joint distribution, and it varies depending on which technique you use. And statistical techniques are used in many different ways, and so I'm treating them here as a method to construct a complete poverty measure. And yet what we all know is that many of them do not arrive at a poverty measure. They may arrive at an individual level poverty score, like the DHS Wealth Index, or they may be used in a sense to understand the structure of the data, as we often do, and I think Anna and Adriana may present tomorrow. As we are actually playing with the data set, we may do some exploratory analysis, or just to really understand the variables, and not use it either for identification or aggregation. But these methods can be used for identification and for aggregation, and that's what I'm really going to focus on here. So we could broadly categorize the statistical methods into those focused on describing relationships and those who are using some latent variable models. And the primary ones that are simply descriptive are the cluster analysis, PCA, and multiple correspondence analysis. And the most familiar ones that are latent variable would be factor analysis, and then structural equation model. So just a couple user notes. You use PCA when data are cardinal, and use multiple correspondence analysis when data are ordinal, because then you're creating a BERT matrix or an indicator matrix, which is the appropriate way of handling ordinal data. PCA is often in practice used for data that are ordinal, but you really have to think and justify if you do that in your empirical work. Why and how are you justifying the use of that technique? The model, based methods I've already gone through. So in both cases, the descriptive and the model-based measures are going to summarize either well-being or deprivation. And in practice, as you know, some of these are going to be looking at well-being, and then after we have created individual well-being scores using PCA, we'll apply a poverty line, identify who's poor, and go from there. And some of them immediately move to constructing deprivations. So that's why I have well-being slash deprivation, because depending on the particular application, they will do one or the other. So they identify at different stages in different applications. And both may combine indicators, therefore, into a composite measure, which is a component, an axis, or a factor. And the differences between the methods is the mathematical procedures used for constructing these composite factors, axes, or components. So what we've done in the book, which I think is quite helpful and perhaps new, is simply to identify some sub-steps of aggregation, each of which require particular decisions, which in a sense constitute these different statistical methods. So you begin with your achievement matrix, which is an N by D matrix of your years of schooling, your education, your body mass index, your access to services. And that's an N by D matrix, as you see. And then you apply a statistical technique to it, and you try to reduce the dimensionality. So you're going to get the components, the factors, or the axes, and have a smaller number of dimensions, an N by D squiggle matrix. And I've lost the squiggle on the D, and I do apologize. If anybody can tell me how to put it back, I'd be glad to. So this matrix is an N by D squiggle matrix. And then you take this reduced matrix, and then for each person, you're going to aggregate across their D squiggle components, factors, or axes. And so you're going to come up with a vector, an N by one vector, where each person has a score. And that score is some aggregation of their person-specific achievements or deprivations. And then finally, you may or may not go to the last stage, which is to aggregate across all people, aggregate across this N by one vector to create a scalar value, your PCA-based measure. This is not how it's usually taught, but I think it's quite useful, and it does apply to the relevant measures. So the reason why I think it's useful is often these sub-stages are not made explicit, and particularly if you are in Stata and just sort of go away, you may not be understanding each of these sub-stages. And I think it's actually really quite important to do so, because each of those sub-stages makes some decisions that you need to make sure that you are happy with if you're using these techniques. So I'll just begin with some examples and then go through PCA in depth and leave it at that. So, for example, when you are doing a principal component analysis, you have to decide, are you going to extract your components from the unstandardized covariance matrix or from the correlation matrix? You can do either. Which are you going to do? Which does Stata do? Why? The results will differ depending on that choice. A second is you then have your different components or your factors. How many are you going to keep? And why? Why? How are you going to justify what you keep? Sometimes you keep them because they explain 80% of the variance. Sometimes you keep them because the eigenvalue is greater than 1. Sometimes you look at the scree plot and you look for the break. Those three ways of choosing how many components to keep may arrive at the same number, or they may differ. If they differ, why are you using one rather than another? Okay? And then how do we combine these factors so you have an N by D squiggle matrix? And how are you going to aggregate into a person-specific deprivation score? There are many ways of doing it, a simple mean, using the loadings, using rescaled weights, but from which matrix, the correlation or the covariance matrix. So there are many different ways, again, of reducing that N by D squiggle matrix into an N by one vector of individual scores. And our observation is that the people who use these techniques are often unaware of them and really haven't thought them through. And yet they do have consequences empirically for the final results, at least in some cases. So I'm going to go through each of the subsets one by one and sort of repeat what I said, but just in a little bit more detail. So the first step, as we saw, was to reduce the matrix, to reduce the number of dimensions. And we're going to do that by looking at your total variance or by looking at common variance. So PCA and MCA, basically, you're trying to account for most of the information in the original set, but using a smaller number of components or axes. And in principal component analysis, you are obtaining uncorrelated or orthogonal components. And each of them is a weighted sum of the observed indicators. So you could take the D indicators, and then you put weights on them, and you can construct each of the orthogonal components. And those are called axes in multiple correspondence analysis. And the factor analysis and the other model-based approaches are going to assume that this whole set of d variables vary according to an underlying statistical model. And that model partitions variance into the total variance, the common variance across indicators and the unique variances of each indicators. And so you're going to retain in factor analysis d common factors, and you're trying in factor analysis to explain the common variance of all of these indicators together. So the second stage is where you then aggregate across your reduced matrix all these d squiggle dimensions to create your n by 1 vector. And there are many different ways. It can be simply the weighted average of the d hat variables. It could be generated by a multivariate model, and we have some examples of that in the chapter, including those done by Paolo Bajon, a former research officer here, still collaborating with Ofi from Peru. And there are naturally many different ways of creating this aggregation, as you can imagine. And then the last is to create a scalar measure, which reflects poverty, so your poverty measure. And again, it might be that you actually have a vector of achievements. And so you're going to use a poverty line to identify who is poor, and it's often a relative one, although it could also be absolute. And then you'll aggregate information using any functional form of poor people into a poverty measure. So each of these are decisions that are taken and often not explicitly justified and really could be, particularly if you're going into depth in these approaches. Let me just give you one example, which is the most widely known example. It's the wealth index, which is present in the demographic and health surveys and also in some others. How many of you know the DHL's wealth index or have used it? A few people. If you download the DHS data, it's there. I don't know if it'll be there in the data sets that you'll be given. But you'll have, in a sense, which quintile the person is in. So this was done by Dion Filmer and Pritchett. And they use PCA, and they apply it to a set of asset variables that are present in the demographic and health surveys. And they retain the first principal component. And then they standardized the asset index scores to have a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. And this was done at the household level because assets are household variables. But then each individual, baby, grandmother, granny, grandfather, mother, obtained the same household indicator. And then all individuals were ranked in the sample according to that score. And then they divide the population into quintiles. And they don't then sum into a scalar, but they do divide population into quintiles of wealth according to that particular asset index. And that approach has been widely applied in others because it's very easy it does, in some sense, create a relative ranking of households by a vector of indicators. So I haven't gone into others. And for example, Louis-Marie Asseline and others have done very good work on multiple correspondence analysis. And multiple correspondence analysis may be the most relevant for us because it's appropriate when data are are ordinal. And so it can be widely used. And it's also interesting to do, even if you don't actually use it for measurement, just looking at the plots that come out of a multiple correspondence analysis, again, you're understanding the relationships among the indicators much better. And so if you're just playing with a data set to get to know it, it's a very useful exercise. What are the advantages of these different approaches? They clearly all address multidimensionality. They all take in the joint distribution of deprivations. Some of them can be used with ordinal data, and others can be used if you justify with ordinal data. And they will always help to clarify how indicators are related to each other. What are some disadvantages? One, which is not spoken about a great deal, and that's perhaps because statistical methods are often not discussed alongside the other methodologies we've been looking at, is that some of the properties that they respect or violate are not clear. And we haven't had the time to really look into this in depth, and it might be a topic for one of you to do. But you know, what happens to monotonicity? What happens to deprivation focus? What happens to subgroup decomposability with these different, with one particular specification, for example, of these indicators? It's quite important to think through the properties, but in that literature, the habit is not to clarify the properties or axioms that these measures respect. So we actually don't know what properties they satisfy. A second, which we mentioned yesterday, is that they are specific to a particular data set. And so if you are going to compare across space or time, you have to pool data sets. And then when you update, you have to pool with the new one and redo all of the back calculations. And so it's a bit more difficult to undertake those comparisons because they are all data-driven. It also can be difficult to communicate. I didn't have time to find, and I wanted to find for you, a slide that our colleague José Manuel Roche made with the weights on the DHS asset index. But when you actually put up in front of a class the weights that the PCA gives in a particular country to the assets in order to create the first component, then the people say, but why? Why is that weighted so much and that weighted so little? And so the normative sense or the communicability of this index to civil society can be quite limited. So you simply have to justify it as being scientific and hope they believe you. For example, your own Smits has done a very interesting wealth index, which is comparable across countries using an extended PCA method. But again, his weights, the weight of a mobile phone versus access to road, are quite difficult sometimes to understand or justify normatively. As we saw in the case of the DHS Wealth Index, there may be identification of the poor simply in relative terms, in terms of percentiles. There could be, you could, of course, using your DHS Wealth score, set a poverty line. But to set a poverty line that people would take seriously, you'd have to explain to policymakers what these individual scores mean with these weighted aggregates of the individual indicators, and then what is the normative justification of that poverty line. And in practice, that sometimes can be a bit difficult to do, hence the use of relative cutoffs. And then the final consideration is that they are sensitive to design decisions. Of all of the types that I've already mentioned, the matrices used, how many components you keep, how you justify it, how you aggregate across people, and how you collapse into a scalar. And these are not often made transparent. And one of the arguments that Amartya Sen has that I guess I hold on to quite strongly is that we who design measures should try to make these decisions and the implications of our decisions transparent, so that people who are not living, eating, breathing, and sleeping poverty measures can still see what we're doing and criticize us and help us to improve our poverty measures. That being said, while it may be difficult to use these measures for a national poverty measure, which is updated every year, as I've said, we will be using them, certainly, in exploring data and in understanding different relationships. And often you will also use these to create sub-indices in a particular variable. There was a workshop at OFI in 2008 on weighting, for example, where we included Andrea Saltelli, the author of the handbook on composite indicators, and we included other people who use statistically based weights and MIMIC models, Paolo Jayakrishna Kumar and others, together with people who use normative weights or survey-based weights, to really discuss when and how to use these statistical techniques. And it was interesting that by the end of that workshop, they had agreed that the statistical weights can be used for aggregation within dimensions, but perhaps across dimensions, aggregation and weights should be normal, should be normative. So I'll move on to fuzzy set and briefly axiomatic, and then we'll pause for questions, and then a much shorter session on chapter 4. So how many of you have used fuzzy sets? How many of you think of fuzzy peaches or fuzzy animals? Okay. The fuzzy set approach is an approach that washing machines use, just to start with the basics. You put your clothes into the washing machine, and I was somewhere, and it actually had this option. You can either have it set to time, or you can set a fuzzy threshold of how dry you want your clothes. And then the washer uses fuzzy logic to decide when to turn itself off. I was in Spain, actually. So what's the motivation for this in poverty? Most thresholds, the deprivation cutoffs, Z, and the poverty cutoff, K, in multidimensional space, dichotomize people into crisp sets. You are or are not deprived in education. You are or are not malnourished. You are or are not poor. So the deprivation cutoffs and the poverty cutoff both dichotomize. And yet, often we are uncertain about where to set the cutoffs. And so fuzzy logic and the fuzzy set theory is one way of trying to capture this uncertainty, take it out, look at it, and in a sense, mathematically help us to articulate our own uncertainty in poverty measures. Zadeh in 1965 was one of the early authors on this. There are lovely books on fuzzy set theory. Kelly and Lemmy have a very, very good book on it, and lots of references in the chapter to this literature. But the basic idea is you have the people who are poor by a dollar a day, and you have the people who are non-poor, and one earns 99 cents and one earns a dollar and a penny. And are they really that different? Now, come on. We know they're not. There's also a conceptual motivation, and many of the people who extended fuzzy set theory into multidimensional poverty, such as Enrica Chiappero Martinetti at University of Pavia, have really drawn on Sen's work to motivate her own. And in Inequality Reexamined, Sen wrote that if an underlying idea has an essential ambiguity, then a precise formulation of that idea must try to capture that ambiguity rather than attempt to lose it. Even when precisely capturing an ambiguity proves to be a difficult exercise, that's not an argument for forgetting the complexity and seeking spuriously narrow exactness. So in social investigation and measurement, it is, and this is the highly quoted bit, it is undoubtedly more important to be vaguely right than precisely wrong. So people love that quote. It comes up a lot. If you write a paper on fuzzy poverty, put it in. They'll love you. So fuzzy set techniques explore how to be vaguely right. And usually, fuzzy set theory is applied in multidimensional poverty settings either to the deprivation cutoffs or to the poverty cutoff. But it can also be applied, as Muzaffer Kizilbash and Enrica Chiappero Martinetti did, to the choice of dimensions. And it can also be applied to weights. I'm going to speak of it simply in terms of deprivation and poverty cutoffs. So we saw that Venn diagrams focus on crisp sets. You are in or you are out. And fuzzy logic uses set theory, but it extends set theory to identify varying degrees of membership in the sets of poor or deprived and non-poor or non-deprived. So the traditional is to have people who are poor identified as one. Your membership is that you are 100% a member of the set of the poor, and people who are non-poor identified as zero. You are 100% outside the set of the poor, and there is a crisp line. There are two ways of having fuzzy logic. One is unbounded, where you say, you know, I don't know where the poverty line is. So I'm just going to have some function of your achievement give me the probability of your being a member of the set of the poor. So there is no there may be a poverty line or there may not, but the membership is graded. The much more common one is to create poverty bounds. So what you do is you set a lower poverty line beneath which everybody is definitely poor. And then you set an upper poverty line above which everybody is definitely non-poor. And then you have this band of people who are in the middle, and you're not quite sure if they're poor or not. And so that's where the definitely poor people have a membership value of one, they're definitely poor. The definitely non-poor people above your poverty line have a membership value of zero. And the people who are inside the poverty band have some membership function value between zero and one. So they're in the middle. Now what's key for this, this sounds beautiful, but the key trick is how do you choose the membership function? How do you choose the cardinal value to apply to people who are between the lower and the upper poverty lines? And then when you go to aggregate people, you will use their degree of membership in the group of poor at the individual level. That will also create their individual membership score. And the overall poverty index is just a function of all of the membership functions. And if non-poor people are zero, then it reflects focus. So your membership, your achievement, and your weight. So these together are summed across a given person for each of the different indicators and then divided by the sum of the weights. So this has been applied in many different settings. And in a sense, it's quite useful in the fuzzy set literature to look at the applications because it clarifies a lot of the theory, because the applications use and apply different membership functions look at their robustness and look at their different tests. I'm not, in this class, going to go through the membership functions. Four of the most common ones are in the chapter that we distributed, and there are many, many, many other varieties. So what are some of the advantages of this? First, it can, because it relies on set theory, it can be used with ordinal data as well as cardinal data. A second advantage is it clearly emphasizes identification either of deprivation and or of poverty, but at least of one or the other. And it's really trying to fine-tune that identification. It's compatible with different poverty methodologies in terms of aggregation. So if you have a fuzzy identification, you can then use many different functional forms to aggregate. Often, in fact, a summary measure is used. And if a summary measure is used, then there is naturally a hierarchy, trade-offs, and a complete ordering or ranking of different people, and therefore of different people at least. Satya Chakravarti did an interesting paper, which is worth a look if you're interested in combinations of fuzzy logic and axiomatic approaches. And he clarified some of the standard axioms that some of the fuzzy set theories respect. And fuzzy set theories do, as the multidimensional extensions of them that I've presented, do consider the joint distribution. The disadvantage primarily is the difficulty or the uncertainty about how to justify the membership function that you choose. And it's particularly important because in the empirical work we do see that the choice of membership of function does affect the results, often empirically. And yet it's hard to argue when you actually don't know who's poor between these lower and upper bounds, then how do you know how to create the probability that somebody is poor? So how do you assess different membership of functions and argue normatively about them? Also, the applied literature doesn't always have many robustness tests, so there's not a standardized procedure yet of assessing robustness across, say, a chosen set of membership functions. Now, this is a controversial point, We haven't discussed as much as perhaps we should of ordinal data. And there are differences of opinion in how to treat ordinal data. But as Schumann presented yesterday, and as our ordinality axiom shows, we take a more conservative opinion, and we think that if data are ordinal, then the underlying data and the poverty measure should be used in such a way that any final poverty result is robust to different monotonic transformations of the data and the cutoffs used. If that is your understanding of ordinal data, some of the applied literature and some of the membership functions treat ordinal data as cardinally meaningful, and so would violate the ordinality axioms. There's also an interesting example I'll give in a moment about conflict with dominance results. Sometimes, as in the case of Chakravarti, the properties are specified and sometimes they are not. But I think that the other, besides justifying the membership function, the other real difficulty in practice with fuzzy set theory is that they begin so intuitive. You all know that 99 and $1, you know, there's some problem with a crisp poverty line. And so every policymaker is with you. But then when you come back to your policymaker with your membership function and with perhaps different membership functions for every deprivation cutoff and for your poverty cutoff, and then all the robustness results, it becomes quite complex and difficult to communicate. So I think a challenge for the fuzzy set literature is really to address those particular issues. So here's an example where dominance would give a different example, give a different result than if you had a lower poverty bound of 6 and an upper poverty bound of 9. I will, in the interest of time, leave this for you to work through in your own time. But it's interesting that there are difficulties there. Now, so fuzzy set theory perhaps is difficult to use to create a measure for policy. But it still remains essential to consider ambiguity. And again, there are other methodologies for doing so that we will touch on. So later today, Adriana will present aspects of the global MPI, and you will hear two very important things. One is that she will present not one, but three, actually, different poverty cutoffs, 20%, 33%, and 50%. These are a very crude way, which is always used in income poverty, with reporting different poverty lines, of looking at the ambiguity in results and how things change when you apply different poverty cutoffs. She will also share a set of measures which have different deprivation vectors. So we'll have a poverty measure, and then we'll have a destitution measure. And these actually carry different deprivation vectors, or deprivation vectors which differ in 8 of the 10 indicators. That's another way of trying to recapture some of the ordinal information which is lost when you dichotomize. And next week, we will look at robustness and sensitivity tests and dominance analysis. And I should mention also that qualitative information, participatory insights, are not something that we teach here, but they are vital, really, to understand ambiguity, because there's nothing like going to really understand real situations to show you the weakness of your own measure in practice, the people it excludes, the people it includes, and really to draw your attention to its limitations. And this kind of ambiguity perhaps is best captured in qualitative studies. So the last one is very brief, and it because it is so big. There are many, many different axiomatic methodologies for multidimensional poverty measurement. But as we saw yesterday and we discussed informally this morning, the motivation of axiomatic measures, and in unidimensional, these included the Sen index or the Foster-Gerth-Thorbeck family of measures, and in multidimensional space, many others that we'll be looking at now. The motivation is to know for certain how a measure will respond when you decompose it by subgroups, or when a poor person gets an extra deprivation, or when something else happens, a person transfers a deprivation to a less poor person. And you will want then to to be able to choose which properties are important to you and to the purpose of your measure. And the axioms basically clarify these aspects of measures. And so we've already mentioned Sen's 1976 article. The nice thing about old articles is they're short. Who's read the FGT? It doesn't take you very long. So Sen 1976, very short. So you can read them. It's not one of these mega 50-page papers. But there are a number of unidimensional poverty measures we've gone through that basically set out the properties and the motivation and that all of the subsequent literature has drawn on. Just for those of you who are interested, very briefly, there are different ways of using properties and axioms. And the terminology is not always consistent, and I haven't been particularly consistent today. But there are two possible ways of using properties. What we've done so far has not been to characterize. So you could introduce a set of properties. You want subgroup decomposability. You want, I don't know, focus. You want these others. And then you might be able to derive a measure that is the only measure in the world, and you can prove this mathematically, that satisfies those properties. If you've done that, then you've characterized a measure. You've shown that not only does this measure satisfy those properties, but it's the only measure that does. The second, which is in a sense what we will be focusing on usually today, is that we will be able to introduce a number of properties that we consider to be desirable, and then we will be able to say with certainty that this measure satisfies those properties. There might be another measure that also satisfies those properties, but this measure definitely does. If you use it, you can look your policymaker in the eye and promise that nothing suspicious is going to happen in terms of the methodology. So in either of these cases, the question is really which principles are important for which purpose of the exercise. And there's no right or wrong answer for that. And so as you've seen, we can go through them and clarify them. But at the end of the day, it's you have to think about why you are using this measure and which axioms it requires. The first paper taking an axiomatic approach to poverty was, to my knowledge, and you may know something else, and fill me in here, please, if you do, was by Satya Chakravarti together with Mukherjee and Ranada in 1998, a chapter of a book in which he specified a number of desirable axioms for multidimensional poverty measures, including factor decomposability. And the next published paper was Tsui, 2002, although by the late 1990s, 98, 99, a lot of working papers were flying around, including the Bourguignon-Chakravarti paper, published in 2003. Bourguignon-Chakravarti, and we should add to this Atkinson, both published papers in 2003 in the first issue of the Journal of Economic Inequality that are really the landmark papers. If you read two papers, please read those two, because Atkinson's is quite readable, and ours, our entire work builds on Atkinson 2003. He suggested combining axiomatic and counting approaches. And Bourguignon-Chakravarti are, you know, the most widely read, and for example, they clarified that multidimensional, in their definition, requires a deprivation cutoff for each indicator. Chakravarti and D'Ambrosio are an interesting measure of social exclusion that uses ordinal data, and Basso Chakravarti and D'Ambrosio actually has been published, so 2009 is the working paper version, but it was published in 2012. Masumi and Lugo use information theory generalized entropy measures to derive, and that's published in the book on multidimensional poverty, edited by Kakwani and Silber. So there are many different approaches. I'm running out of time, so I will not go through identification, just make a quick jump through that. The requirements of the measures are that the data come from the same survey. Most of the measures, except for the Chakravarti and D'Ambrosio that I mentioned, most of these early measures required cardinal data. So they presumed cardinal data, and they used the normalized gaps and all of also the properties, for example, of non-increasing under-correlation switch are require the cardinal data. But some of them, including those listed here, are meaningful for ordinal dimensions. All of the axiomatic measures that we've listed do consider the joint deprivations, and they usually create a summary measure. And they, some of them, as we've seen, allow ordinal variables, although many of them do not. So you do have to look very carefully which ones do or do not. And their advantages to really clarify how this particular measure will behave in different circumstances. To date, we have not found one measure that satisfies every property, but that's actually not uncommon. And we do have some forthcoming work with James Foster showing an impossibility theorem that we cannot satisfy certain measures, certain axioms at the same time, such as those reflecting inequality among the poor and dimensional decomposition. And some of the measures, the final figures, are difficult to interpret intuitively. You can compute them. They're quite easy to compute. You get a number, but then interpreting it and explaining it can be quite difficult. So I'm going to break now. I'm sorry to go on for so long, but this is the only review you will get. And the counting approach is very light and easy after this. But are there questions of clarification at this point? Yeah, Lou.
So the axiomatic approaches have a lot of mathematical backing that give them normatively desirable properties. But do we also have reason to believe that they're useful analytically as an entity in predicting regression associations and sort of empirical relationship between people?
I'm looking for my colleagues. You know, they haven't been used that much.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a literature that began in 2003,
okay.
Right? And with the AF methods, mm-hmm. now we are seeing, you know, proper
okay.
analysis, and it's just now.
Okay.
And so in a sense, it's a field which is developing, and I'm hoping you will develop it further and tell us the answers. But no, I think the jury is out in terms of predictive value. And they haven't been widely implemented for applied work. It's mostly been in academic settings thus far, many of the axiomatic measures. For sound.
Thank you. When you are doing poverty, income poverty analysis, sometimes what is done is to rank the incomes or consumptions of the households. And then what they do is try to see what is the normal consumption in the community that would help to set up the poverty line. So they take the 40% below. Okay, those are poor. The 60% above, those are non-poor. So between the 40 and 60% is the one they try to see what is the consumption pattern that help to define a more realistic poverty line. It is from there that the goods, or the bundle of goods are selected because it's referring to what would be a common consumption or normal consumption in that community. And from there, that we do select the major products and we define their poverty line and also the non-poverty line. Is that part of the FUSI approach? I'm really outside the world now.
It shares the motivation, but it doesn't share the techniques that I understand. So you have you're doing relative, you're doing 40 and 60% of the median, which is a standard relative poverty measure, as the lower and the upper bound. And you're recognizing there's ambiguity in the middle. But then instead of doing some membership function, a trapezoidal membership function or a different one, you are doing this other way of assessing, you know, what should be the poverty status of those in the middle. So it's related in motivation, but not in technique. Yeah. Shall I just race through counting and then you can have coffee? Or are there other things? No? Okay. I know this is only once, but someday when you're in front of a bunch of people, you're going to be glad you had it. Okay, the counting approaches, I'm just going to basically give you a history of the counting approaches in Latin America and in Europe. In Europe, they're relatively well documented, and if you are interested, you should look at Nolan and Whelan's 2011 book, Poverty and Deprivation in Europe. In Latin America, there is one historical article by Ferez and Mancero, but there doesn't seem to be an exhaustive history of the counting approaches in Europe. Sorry, in Latin America. And in other regions, such as the Arab states, again, these reports are out, but there doesn't seem to be a systematic review in English of their applications. So what I'm going to do here is just give a brief history and then illustrative applications. And obviously from the 19th century, 1880 school board was the first implementation of a monetary-based poverty measure in the UK, for example, that then was improved upon by Booth and Rowntree. So from the late 19th century, the prevailing approach to measuring poverty was monetary. And Townsend, 1954, explains how the poverty line was understood. But since the 1970s, counting approaches have been used. They've been used in a sense with independent origins. People sometimes discover the same techniques rather independently. I don't know if they were independent. I don't know if these people knew each other. I'm not a historian. But we can see quite different instantiations of similar techniques. And the techniques are as follows. You have a list of relevant variables. You have a weight on each indicator. You define your deprivation cutoff, who is malnourished, who doesn't have enough education, who doesn't have enough money, who lives in poor housing. And you create a binary deprived or non-deprived score for each person in each indicator. And then using the weights, you sum them up. Most commonly, equal weights were used to create a weighted score, or in the case of equal weights, a number of deprivations each person experiences. And then you either report people having different numbers of poverty, or you create a poverty measure by setting a threshold, a second cutoff, such that if the person's deprivation score is above this poverty score, they are considered poor. So it's a very intuitive, friendly, and policy-relevant methodology. And as Atkinson 2003 pointed out, people in welfare economics were a bit sniffy about it because it was, in a sense, so easy. And yet it was used in policy. And a lot of the much more sophisticated methods were not. So in Latin America, it arose really alongside an approach which came to be known as the basic needs approach. One of the landmarks was the Cocuyuc Declaration in 1974, which argued that human beings have basic needs. And they thought that simply looking at monetary poverty was not enough. And this approach, the basic human needs approach, was then taken up. Francis Stewart at this university, together with Norm Hicks, Paul Streeton, and others, developed it as a conceptual framework. The World Bank, the ILO, other international institutions implemented basic needs programs. McNamara's famous 1979 speech cites basic needs. And then in other regions, basic needs approaches happened. For example, Julio Botvinnik from Mexico flew over to Lebanon to inform the first Lebanese basic needs map, poverty map of unmet basic needs. So what they did was draw attention to the oversight of simply using a monetary measure and call for looking at initially commodities in addition simply to money. And so in a sense, they were trying to look at direct deprivations, what Sen 1981 would have called direct deprivations. And because they had this list of basic needs, implicitly there was an equal weighting early on, and so implicitly they simply counted the number of these essential items that people lacked. I'll come back a little bit more to how that was implemented, but in terms of history, now let's move to Europe in 1968, or even before in 1954, UNX group was set up because already then they were worried about GNP per capita and had criticisms of it. And so they proposed to measure well-being using level of living. And Sweden implemented a level of living survey in 1968. And that Ericsson 1993, his article in The Quality of Life by Sen and Nussbaum, sort of documents that Scandinavian experience. It's called Having Loving Being. And then Jacques Delors really brought the issue of the need for data on social indicators to prominence in Europe, because they didn't have the survey data they needed to look at non-monetary deprivations. And the generation of social indicators in the late 60s and 70s, the discussion about it, and then the subsequent survey instruments enabled empirical work on non-monetary aspects of poverty. In Europe, although the word basic needs was used, for example, by Johan Galtung, Human Rights in Another Key, and his writings, again, as human rights were articulated in the 1960s, the more common phrase was social exclusion. And Le Noir, in 1974, articulated this concept of social exclusion, which has often been used to refer to multidimensional poverty in that region. And the European Commission, 1992, tried to clarify how social exclusion was different than poverty, and said that it also focuses on the mechanisms of exclusion, not just the aspects of poverty itself. So what are some implementations? I will leave the slides and not go through these, but Peter Townsend here in the UK was a very visible, and Bristol remains a very visible center of study on counting approaches. Initially, he defined 60 indicators in 12 dimensions and equally weighted them. And then he focused on a short list of 12. And then he said people need to have more than one, because people are idiosyncratic and will indulge in certain luxuries and apply certain prohibitions for religious, moral, educational, or other reasons, whether they are rich or poor. So he thought one indicator didn't reflect poverty, but you needed several deprivations. And then he also used statistical techniques of correlations, for example. And his emphasis was to validate an income poverty line using non-income deprivations. Mack, who's a journalist in Lansing in 1985, when Margaret Thatcher was here and said there was no poverty in the UK, wrote a book that slightly disagreed with her called Poor Britain. And they had a couple innovations. One was to ask people in surveys what they needed, and they called the socially perceived necessities. And they used people's perceptions of minimal needs to construct their list of basic needs. And they also asked if people didn't have these things because they didn't want them or because they couldn't afford them. And this enforced lack, rather than people's own preferences, became the key to deprivations. And there are a lot of other studies in Europe and in also the States in the last two references, which implemented similar counting-based approaches. And in Latin America, it was very different. In Europe, there was a lot of discussion about what are the right indicators? How do we match these indicators to people's values? You know, that became really the centerpiece of the counting approaches implementations. But in Latin America, from the beginning, CAST in 1975 used data from Argentina's census to develop the first census-based measure of unsatisfied basic needs. And across Latin America, the UBN approach was picked up, but it usually used census indicators. And with CEPAL or ECLAC's leadership, it often used a fixed set of indicators, often those that were present in censuses. But also there was not discussion on people's values or on how to to shape the lists as much in the census-based work. What they did create were poverty maps that were very widely used by policymakers. So using the census data, of course, they could have fantastic maps of unsatisfied basic needs and also break these down by dimension. So that's the basic, pencil sketch, and then it has been elaborated in many different ways, both methodologically, with work by Julio Boltvinnik, and in other regions by NGOs like Kodambashri in Kerala of India, or BRAC in Bangladesh, or Mark Schreiner has developed a whole methodology of poverty scorecards. And these all innovate on the counting-based techniques, and now are quite a wide literature. But as you can see, this literature is distinctive in that it is much more applied, and there are very few academic papers or methodological papers surrounding it. So the pros of the counting approach are that it is clear, it's simple, it's transparent and intuitive in terms of identification of who is deprived. It's the number or the weighted sum of deprivations they experience. It clearly considers the joint distribution of deprivations, and it can be used with cardinal or ordinal data. Sometimes a summary measure is made. Sometimes you report the percentage of people deprived in one or two or three indicators. And the most important is that it was very actively used for policy in many regions. But the con is that most often it was used with a headcount ratio, and so that drove policymakers to take barely poor people above the poverty line and perhaps neglect the deeply poor people that would not be able to be moved out of poverty immediately. And then some of the methods of aggregation, perhaps such as that of Julio Boltvinnik, cardinalized ordinal data in a way that is controversial or at least could be discussed. And also, the counting measures use dichotomous data, and so they are not sensitive to the depth of deprivations for identification. So I will stop there. It's a lot of material. But I think with this lecture, you basically have the groundwork covered in terms of background that you will need to start the course. And hopefully, there's enough that something here has struck your imagination, and you'll go and read a little bit further or explore a little bit further. And we are around, of course, if you have particular questions. But if there are questions that you think would be relevant to everyone else, then please do ask them now. Yes.
In your last statement about the counting approach, you said there's a little bit of scope for the policymakers to neglect the deeply poor one. I didn't get it exactly how. I thought it covers the deeply poor one, isn't it?
It covers them, but if it uses a headcount ratio, if it says that 70% of people are deprived in one or more deprivations, and 50% are deprived in two or more, then if I'm a policymaker, I'm going to focus on the people who are deprived in one deprivation and try to remove it, so I get 70 down to 60. And I'm going to focus on people who are deprived in two deprivations and try to remove both of them, so I get 50 down to 40. But I'm not going to focus on people who are deprived in five things at the same time. So one of the innovations of the AF methodology, how it builds on the counting approach, is by factoring this the intensity, the average shared deprivations, because by putting that in, just like putting in the gap, income gap in the poverty gap measure, you're giving policymakers an incentive to reduce the intensity of poverty at the same time, because poverty measure will go down either if people get out of poverty, the headcount ratio changes, or if the intensity changes. But if you're only including headcount, then you're blind to that intensity.
Right. So it's not the problem with the methodology, but how you interpret it. I think if you use the headcount from it, then only the problem is.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.